$5,000. Well, even if I'm downtown, we're paying $35,000 a tip them. What could they do with that? I mean, it's all about money.
I'm sure it's for some kind of.
That's kind of what I said about economic development. You can wish all you want to for economic.
Please stand for a pledge.
America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mayor Grimminger.
Here.
Alderwoman Codwell. Alderman Couch.
Here.
Alderman John Stupi.
Here.
Alderman Jokers.
Here.
Alderman Hook.
Here.
Alderman Donnie Stupi. Alderman Prince.
Here.
Alderman Ruzicka.
Here.
Mayor, we have a quorum.
Thank you. It doesn't look like we have any. Martin, I think we're to you.
Oh, look out.
We got to approve the agenda.
Oh, all right, I'm sorry. God, how long have I been doing that? Okay, yeah. Approve the agenda.
Please note that she's late.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, now you.
Well, my report is a little briefer than normal because I was off last week. I know how disappointing that is to all of you.
Yeah, we were.
Me being off and my report being brief, but we'll go to it. We've talked a lot about the FEMA damage claims and the fact that we hadn't heard from them. Of course, as soon as we decided to fix the road, they called me and want to set up a meeting. So we're meeting tomorrow. $10,753.06 is what we estimate to be the cost of our cleanup and repair. So that will be the request we'll be making of FEMA, and we have all the documentation to support that. We did the bids on Point Base last week, and there were two, as reflected here. Lappy Cement was the most favorable, $152,993.78. We've dealt with Lappy in the past. Qualified contractor knows how to do it. And I met with them, and because we're concerned about the tight schedule, and I wanted to make sure they could get on it right away. And so we had a discussion about that, and what we'd do, and what they would do, and they seemed to think they could perform without any problems.
Can we have two readings in the ordinance?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Would they be able to, if asked to, extend the project to use the available funds, or is that the available funds?
No, we have another. There was a provision of the contract that the city could extend the scope of the work.
Okay.
We haven't done that because we have the December 20th kind of deadline, and so they're going to get started, see how well it goes. As soon as they think that they can see that they can get it done by December the 20th, we would extend the scope.
Fantastic. Okay, when do we expect them to commence work?
If we get it done tonight, they get their insurance and bond to us. I'll give them notice to proceed tomorrow. They said they'd be on it in a week or so.
Very good. Thank you.
I think it said 7 days they'd be on it.
You got the money there?
Yes.
How much money is going to be left over in TIP after we do this?
$36,000. Well, the TIP will be.
Do we have any plans for this one?
Yeah, depending on what Lappy says, if they can't do it, we've got stormwater work we have to get done. The detention ponds that were TIF are all silted in. Trees
okay,
are growing
so we,
up in them.
We can use all that money.
Well, it'll get used.
Okay, excellent. Great.
And we paid the Civic Center.
The Civic Center has not been paid. They agreed to delay their payment until the end of the year because of the cash flow issue. We won't get our fourth quarter tax receipts until December and January, or January most of them.
January.
And so we have this kind of cash flow problem. You may recall the IDC agreed to make a short-term loan to kind of a bridge loan for a month to get us from there to there. But the community center agreed to delay payment, and we amended that note to the end of the year. And so we're on board, they're on board with it.
Good.
But we'll have the money.
Yes.
The other thing was we're going to have an as-built set of, we have an as-built set of drawings done.
Right, but that's a $3,000.
Yeah.
For what?
For the business park.
The infrastructure, okay. Sewer and the water. And,
okay.
So all the projects that have been done there have all been on separate
okay.
plans right. and stuff. And going forward to present, somebody's interested in something there, instead of going through a bunch of different sheets, we want everything on one set of plans that somebody can look at where all the infrastructure's on.
How about Eric Scott, or have they?
I'm in contact with Eric Scott. The work's been complete. They've been informed of when we have to know, but we need to request reimbursement. And it's been indicated to me that they're going to do that.
They have everything done out there they want
yeah,
to do.
Right. Right.
Yeah,
the cost of the 3rd Street Bridge repair is shown there. We had gotten a bid for asphalt for $3,000, so we did it in concrete for $3,168.92. So I don't think FEMA will be too upset with the fact that we
did it. They did a good job.
Yeah.
Is it done?
It's done. Street's open.
It's open.
It opened today. We took the barriers down.
Good deal.
We finished the use of the dirt patch. We probably could have done a little more, but the county needed to get it back, so we had to give it back to them. We used up all the oil we bought. So. We talked with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers in the past, and we asked them to include the Main Street Trail as one of the eligible expenses that we could make to get reimbursement. And they wrote me an email and said that they can't do that because it's disconnected from the levee property. So I called the guy and I said, we don't understand. He was starting to talk about the section of the trail that goes down to the ferry crossing landing. And I said, okay, if you disregard that, we still have, it's connected to the floodgates and it's across the street from the levee project property. And so he said he would revisit it and see if they couldn't include the portion of the trail that's inside the levee gate, and hopefully I'll hear from him.
Good. We
have been talking over the last, 2 years about water problems for some citizens who are not inside the city, but on Highway 61 south of the city. And lots of options were evaluated, but eventually it was just for cost and regulatory problems. We agreed that we would set a meter up on our line in Valley Springs, and they could run a service line. It won't be part of the city systems up to that meter. That we would monitor the water, we would bill somebody for the water usage, but they would own the line and they'd be responsible for dividing up the charges. We were only going to have one customer. But the city code requires that in order to provide water service, you have to be in the city limits. So the two property owners involved have petitioned the city for voluntary annexation. The statute requires that there be a public hearing before you vote on that, and that you pass a resolution to authorize the advertisement for that public hearing. And so that's on the agenda for tonight.
Martin, can we talk about that now, or you want to wait till later?
Either time.
This is a very simple approach. Okafoos and Roth, they're two properties. If you go down 61, starting, where does the sea limit start? Is that before gag escalating or after? Are they in or are they out?
Yeah.
Okay.
St. Jude Drive.
Right there, there's an arc that catches about, I don't know, 7 or 8 properties. And their properties are not in city limits. The little field behind them is in city limits. To the south of them on the bluff is in city limits on the west side of Highway 61. Okafoos is the farthest south house. and then Mr. Roth is his neighbor. And we have went through this. We initially looked at it and tried to figure out how to get water down there, and it had to be a looping system, and the cost, I don't remember what it was, but it was pretty huge. It was just unfeasible. So through all this time and all these discussions, we came down to a really simple solution to this issue. We set a water meter back in Valley Springs. That's our only cost, setting the water meter. And then Roth and Okenfuss will run their own lines. Their plans, we will only bill one of them. And their plans are to buy two water meters so they can each meter their water so they can be fair about how much usage and who pays what. Tom Okenfuss has also sourced a fire hydrant that he's going to put down there, you know, out on Highway 61. So that's a benefit even really to the backside of Valley Springs. So it's really as simple as it sounds. And as Martin has instructed me, a voluntary annexation, we are not responsible for any commitment of city services to those two properties. So the idea is, well, what about sewer? They don't want sewer. They got good septic systems. And if we had put sewer in there, it would be cost prohibitive. That'd be a grinder and a lift station and all these things. So under a voluntary annexation, we don't have that commitment. Is that correct?
Well, I said it. I checked with the city attorney after I said it to you to confirm it, and yes, that's correct.
Okay. So the only cost, really the only cost to the city is setting a meter, like would for any new residential construction. And then we'll recover our monies from that. Those two properties will pay city taxes. And for those two homeowners, it's really a minor amount. But sooner or later, we need to figure out how to get these other properties in that little arc brought into the city limits. So if their neighbors on to the north of there ever wanted to do the same thing to get city water, we could do the same thing. We move north, put them in a meter, and they can run their own line. So sometimes we look at things and we try to figure out how complex they are, and this one is really simple.
Someday that's going to come back and bite us in the butt, though. It will.
How?
Because we're not offering sewer, okay? And I'm not saying it'll never probably be in our lifetime, but one of these days that property is going to change hands that are going to say,
but we don't have sewer. It can't bite us because we have no obligation to provide sewer.
Well, we're providing water, correct?
Up on the top of the hill at Valley Springs.
Okay.
I'm
all in favor of what we want to do. I'm not saying that. I'm just looking at the other part of it.
If a homeowner ever wanted to get city sewer, just like Okenfuss and Roth, to run their own lines, they could put their own grinder in, their own lift station in, and go up to there. We have no obligation.
Okay.
It's unfortunate that the cost is prohibitive to bring public sewer down to that neighborhood. But it is prohibitive.
I agree with both of you. I agree it's a good thing. I also agree with what Rick said, because that went through my mind too, is what happens down the road but when somebody else owns the property.
We already have the answer. The answer is simple. The city has no obligation to provide those services.
Okay.
It's up to the homeowner,
right,
to, as a seller, to inform in full disclosure to the new buyer, this is what you got.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a closed end. It's not open.
Let me approach a question here, okay? Say I think there's four other property owners down there, and there one, two, three, four. I think it's four.
We counted them. I thought there was like six or seven total.
I think there's six, maybe probably four down there. What happened to these other four people want to add on? What do we do there? They have to run their own line down there, or they can they come off of what we're running down there?
What Okenfuss and Roth are running is theirs. They own it.
Right.
We have no regulation over it. So
we would
have the opportunity to evaluate where the best place to put a water meter was, on to the north or even back there at that spot. And if they wanted to do that, we would to do the exact same thing we would do for Roth and Okenfuss.
I had heard, I don't know, the last time I talked to Tom was Tom Okenfuss, that they were going to run it big enough, I think, that if one of the other neighbors ended up, that's not.
They're going to run a 2-inch water line.
They're running.
They have no obligation to their neighbors, no more than I have to mine or you have to yours.
I suggest they run a four-inch.
How many homes with a two-inch line service?
Two-inch water line will service around 8 homes.
Well, so we're okay.
That's enough.
All right.
Okay. So that would be enough anyway. And that would really be between the neighbors.
That'd be between them.
Not really between the city.
You mentioned the fire hydrant. What kind of line you need for a hot fire?
I was wondering that myself.
Yeah, I don't think it's.
Yeah. I don't disagree that there needs to be a flush hydrant, maybe at the end of the line, but no stake to a fire hydrant.
Well, it's not going to have flows, it's to support.
Won't have a big enough line.
Right, yeah.
And they're not trying to put it into spec. They just thought that it'd be a good idea for their two homes, and it wouldn't hurt, so.
Well, but as Steve said, you have a dead-end line, you need to have a way to flush it, so.
Steve, what kind of volume you can get out of a two-inch line?
No, without computer or paperwork, I'm not sure. Not a two-inch open, wide-open line.
What pressure would you get out there coming down that hill? Did you know that?
Probably around 80, didn't it?
At the bottom.
They were putting a regulator in one.
At the bottom.
So what do we have up in Valley Springs?
60, 70.
There's about a 40-something foot elevation change there.
If you've got only 80 pounds of pressure at the bottom, you don't need that.
But here's the thing. As a city, we're done at the meter. We're done. We can't tell them what to do past that. It's their meter, just like my house and my water meter.
But we're willing to share our expertise.
Certainly, but I'm responsible for my water line from the main to my house, right?
You're responsible for up to one linear foot of your property to your home.
One linear.
What does that mean? A foot from my house?
No, a foot from the street right away.
Right. So that's no different than what they're proposing to do. They're responsible for their water line, like we are all responsible for our water line.
Like I said, I'm in favor of it. I just had some questions.
Well, and you know, I mean, I went through this, and it's just, it really breaks down to being extremely simple. We're going to put a water line, we're going to put a meter in, and we're done. And we're going to get two of those properties annexed in the city. We have talked about annexation for years, and this is a voluntary annexation. We've had committee meetings, we've went through things, we've looked west, we've looked north, we've looked south. There's no loser in this.
One thing we might want to add somewhere is if, and it would entirely be up to those two, if any of the other neighbors want it to tap onto that line. That obviously is between all of those people down there. But we would need to require that whoever tapped on would have to annex also.
That's correct. Although, actually, we would still only be billing one person.
True, but they would still have to be the city.
I think that would make sense that we'd require that. But really, that's not even at the current discussion. We're going to set a meter. They're going to run a line to it. They're not going to have a hall.
But we need to
put in a condition on their.
They don't have a right to extend it to whoever they want to.
I think they would be in favor of that condition.
I think that would be a good topic for the public hearing when they would be here.
They would not be opposed to that condition. They just don't want to have to truck water in.
Sure.
I don't blame them.
I don't either.
Yeah. Right.
That would get old.
And you all agree.
Fast.
Whenever this first came up several months ago, that, try to take care of them.
Right.
This was a good solution that Alliance came up with that we didn't have to.
Right.
I rode on the property last week. Yeah. They look like they have everything cleared out. They're ready to go with the line.
They have agreements with the other property owners where the line would have to cross. And really, that's none of our business. Anyway, we're setting a meter.
Right.
But I think it's all in the up and up. And I think that you know, Mr. Okafus has experience in the industry. And he knows what to do and how to do it.
Yeah, so he can get that down in a hurry.
Correct.
All right.
While we're at it, I'd like two more properties added to it. Island 32 that I talked about years ago.
Well, you got to help us, John, because we don't know what you're talking about.
I'll talk to you after the meeting because I don't think they were going to sign. I don't think they will anymore.
Don't talk after the meeting. Talk now.
Yeah, let's hear
what
are
you
got?
Talking about?
Well, Rosner Law Firm. He said he was more than willing 5 years ago to come in.
Okay.
Draw up the papers.
All right. Who else?
Al Geisner. That lot, but I don't know yet. Talking in there.
The city for voluntary.
Let me give to you the form of the petition. It'll be blank, and then, and whenever they want to request it, they can just submit it.
Why don't you just mail it to them?
Okay.
We don't have staff that just goes around knocking on doors and asking people what their hopes and dreams are.
That was brought up years ago in annexation, that I told them that Rosen said, drop the papers, he's ready to sign now, only you have to talk to him.
So what's happened all these years?
I have no idea. They said, well, we'll wait till we're gonna annex, so, I don't know, I mean,
well,
you got people that wanna come in.
That is certainly separate from this. It's certainly something we need to pursue, and if they wanna come in, we need to figure out how we can do that.
I'll send them a letter, enclose the petition, instruct them what to do.
John, you're talking about, are you talking about his business out there?
No, a lot in between his business and Norman Myers.
That's past Redcombe's property.
Al's already in.
The lot ain't though.
The lot is, but his business is already in.
It is, so we just bypassed Coleman's property and took him out there, or what? We had one of those little things and just, I said, well, you know.
We got the community center and all that in there, and Collier, or not Collier, Overlees, I'm sorry.
Well, the piecemeal, we kept going around.
And we've had it.
We've gotten parcels inside the city limits that aren't in the city limits.
I know, which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's been totally ridiculous.
So it's a bigger issue, and we've had a committee, Dick formed a committee, we've had meetings, we looked at all kinds of different things. But I was never aware that somebody said, hey, I wanna come into the city. So if that's the case, we can work on that, we can certainly work on that and see if it works for them and for us and everybody.
They got the water and everything, we don't have to do nothing there.
Okay, so.
Thank you for your time on that.
A while ago, and I don't remember, like last year, we were approached by somebody who wanted to start a community garden, and then they kind of went away. They're back, but now they've been engaged the services of the University of Missouri Extension Service. So what's being proposed now is that the University of Missouri enter into a lease agreement with the city for some piece of property that we own, and that the university then be responsible for implementing the community garden idea.
That's great.
I've had about enough of this community garden stuff. We have two times put in water lines and spigots for two different places for a community garden. I am all for a community garden, but has anyone looked at the area that's proposed? Of what type of grass is there, how they're gonna have a garden, because.
So I met with the Extension Service representative and the person who wants to spearhead this, and I expressed to them that the site they're looking at, I have been told, may not be suitable.
That's what I've been told, and it's just like a previous site.
And the Missouri Extension Service said, well, we're gonna go dig some holes and figure it out before we come back to you.
I don't think we should spend a dime on this until they can come to us with a good plan.
The new community development person.
A very nice young lady, I've met her a couple times.
Is her last name?
Tiffany is her name.
What's her name?
Tiffany.
Well, but I'm just not in favor of spending another dime until somebody comes to us with a real comprehensive plan for a community garden, or we're just running another water line, another spigot, and nothing ever happens. I think it's, in the past, it was good people, good intentions, but they really just didn't do their homework. So this time, we should require them to do their homework, and if the extension office says, this is the right spot, I'm all for it. But if not, I'm done putting these water lines in all over town.
Well, I think the fact that the Extension Service is involved will at least ensure the proper preliminary analysis.
I'm gonna tell you, I'm skeptical. I want them to come before this board and tell us, we have done the soil samples, we know what kind of grass is there, we know how to handle it, and then we'll move forward. Then I'll be all for it.
They know 10 times more than what you and I know about.
I don't know anything, but I know Rick is.
But they know 10 times more than what we know.
We've been through this a couple of times.
Yeah, but you've probably not been through it with them, okay?
But the grass there is the same grass.
You don't know. Can you go look at the grass and see what it is?
All I can do is trust people that tell me this.
And I suspect what they're gonna do is they're gonna dig a hole and say, you can't rely on this soil, and that they will do a raised bed garden, which means you'll have to construct and.
I'm all for a community garden and helping people in the community that don't have a space to garden. But this time, it needs to be done correctly. We've done it twice before, and it wasn't done correctly.
We don't have that much tied up in what we're doing.
Yeah, but you know what, at the same time, listen, I'll say it out loud, I'm done with these Boy Scout projects. They start them, they don't finish them, sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. So we have an obligation to the citizens of St. Genevieve when these things occur, and we spend money on them, that they come to fruition. So all I'm asking is for someone from the extension office to come say, look, we've done our homework, this is the spot, and I'm all for it.
But once again, you're asking for something, and we're not tying any money up in this right now.
Unless, like he says, they
unless
have
we got another run. We've already done it twice. I'm finished with it.
I'm not saying that. They're not asking for any money right now. Right now,
but they
not
will.
Asking for, we don't
they're
know good. That.
How you have a garden if there's no water there?
Truck it.
Truck it.
So then they're going to want to use the city truck to go haul water.
Well, let's don't get the cart before the horse.
Well, I'm just saying, when I first heard about this, it just... This, I really hope that they achieve their goal, and I'd love to help them. But we've done it before because it sounded warm and fuzzy and it's a good idea. Hell yeah, let's do it. Well, I'm done with the warm and fuzzy. Please come with a definitive plan, have your ducks in a row, and we'll all, I'm sure, be all for it.
Okay.
I'm sorry, but that's been a frustrating.
The final part on my short report is not on. It's not written down, but we went to a meeting yesterday. And I want to report to you kind of what the mayor and I were in attendance at a combined meeting of the Industrial Development Corporation and the Chamber Board. And they asked for an update on and an explanation of the TIFs. And Chauncey Buckeye came and talked about the TIFs because there are three of them. There's the one that expires on December the 20th. There's the Ozora TIF and there's the downtown TIF. And so he made his presentation and the discussion after that kind of went in different areas, but most of it had to do with having a concerted, combined, coordinated effort for economic development. And Ron Klein suggested that we put a group together, and I said all the resources are here. I mean, it's not a question of we've inventoried our resources. We know what we have. We know what the labor force is. We know what our utilities are. We know what land is available. All the questions that economic developers have to answer before they start marketing are there. And so I thought what they were saying is we need a concerted marketing effort. And I said that takes resources, and so. They were talking about putting together a group who would come up with resources, which I think would be a wonderful thing. In the context of that discussion, we discussed the city's comprehensive plan. One element of that plan, a small element, is a discussion of economic development. But it is not an economic development plan. But it raised the question of whether we want to reinvigorate the effort to revise our comprehensive plan. The plan was written in 1997. Generally, those plans are considered to have a 20-year lifespan. Year before last, we put together a group, we put together a survey, we completed the survey, and then elections happened and the board changed, and we really haven't taken the next step on continuing to bring the results of that survey back for that committee and talk about revisions to the plan. What we have is the purpose of our comprehensive plan is to establish goals and based on the analysis of the needs of the city from a land use point of view. It is the base document for land use planning. And it should be used whenever a request is made to change land uses in the city. The Planning Commission should review that. They should review it in the context of the comprehensive plan, recommend it to you for approval or denial, and then you should make a decision that's consistent with the comprehensive plan in order for it to withstand any challenges. Without that plan, it's kind of difficult to defend your decision.
Why did it stop? I mean, I know there's committees put together, I know there were meetings held, I know there was a survey held, and I realized that elections happen every year, but I mean, there was work done that turned out to be very effective.
We had staff limitations because Brenda was part of the process, and I guess my point is, if I have, if with the affirmative support of this board, I'm ready to go again.
Good, go.
So does anybody have any reason not to?
No.
Okay.
I don't know that anybody ever had a reason not to. I think that you had a great group of people put together. You had from varied backgrounds and it's not just for economic development. We all understand that, but it's important.
No, we need to, if they want to do that, we need to participate in that. That comes more, much more focused.
As well as an emergency action plan for a variety of issues.
Yeah, of course, that, again.
That's another big one that's, yeah, that's another big one.
Okay, thank you. That's my report.
I guess the only thing in a comprehensive plan, I'm curious, I'm a business owner. There's a window out there of ages that in the next 5 to 7 years, there's a bunch of them going to be retiring and probably selling out. I don't know if anybody realizes that, but you start looking at the businesses and the ages of the people, there's going to be a big turnover here. And there's done already been, there's going to be a lot more in the next probably 5, 7 years.
That's a very good point.
Oh, yeah. And as we lose businesses, we don't get them back because they close up and nobody wants
to. Kids don't want to take over the business and.
No. And that's something they might consider or look into.
Demographics is certainly part of that consideration. That's a good suggestion.
Martin, I had a question. Dave's not going to be here tonight, Pinkley?
No, he's.
Well, it wouldn't be his normal reporting.
He's not on the agenda.
Oh, okay.
But go ahead.
Where do we stand on salt for winter?
We have purchased it. And it's, what was it, $85 a ton, I think? So it's waiting for us to order it.
Sound like the county, I think this was $91 a ton, but they're locked in. If they only use 750 and they pay for 100,000, they got 25,000 next year. That price locked in. So I just wondered where we stood on it. Thank you, Martin.
Any other questions?
Nope.
Steve, your turn.
Evening, everyone.
Hi, Steve.
All right. Start off a little update on the same contractors on St. Mary's Road. They have 10 of the 33 connections in as of today. They started boring some of the service lines in yesterday afternoon, which allows them not to have to open cut the street. They got 5 connections in today, and they're hoping to get another 5 or 6 in tomorrow. And they are aware of the Heritage Days activities for the weekend. They will be cleaned up down there.
Excellent. Good.
Let's see. We replaced the meter at Mississippi Line. There was a lot of slop in the meter, so much to the point that it wore a bushing out of that meter, which was slowing the meter down. Contacted a census rep. They recommend with that much flow through a water meter, that needs to be changed out every year. So that meter is now a wearable item at about $1,200 a year. On the sewer side, well, lead and copper results, all the homeowners should have that participated in that should have received their letter and the results in the mail. If anybody hasn't received it, please contact me. I'll get them to you. Level transducer at lift station one.
Were there any exceedances in those reports?
No, there was not one. Out of 20 samples, they all passed. Lift station one, transducer failed as a level transducer. Tells the pumps where to come on and where to shut off. It failed, causing pumps to run longer, run less. We had to get a engineering firm in here to replace it and reprogram the transducer so it maintained the wet well level.
Steve, when the contractor came across Seraphim Street with the new water line installation, they were courteous as far as providing access to the homeowners on Seraphim Street. That was my personal experience. And when they kind of wrapped up, they cleaned up, they seeded, they did a very clean job.
I'll pass that along to him. Thank you.
Steve, for the weekend, with Heritage Days being down there, they're going to make, I don't know, I haven't been around the last week. I don't know how the street cut is, but is it
be okay?
They're going to make sure that it's filled in and it's...
Yeah, it's fine.
It is, it's good now.
Yeah, there's a couple of spots where it's settled, traffic packed it down. It could use a little gravel in some spots. They're going to address all that before the weekend.
All right, great.
Working on that hydrant on Fifth and Washington?
It'll be installed next week.
Next week, yes.
And the leak up at the ballpark?
Leak at the ballpark was a 2-inch service line that runs to the county fairgrounds building. It was near the hydrant, not at the hydrant, or not the hydrant.
But that by far, because I think it was a little misleading when you read it, when you read the paper last week with the county commission's report as far as that by far was not the water that was coming down through the parking lot all summer. That was just a little bitty part of it if that was leaking at that time at all.
And the water that was coming across the parking lot over the summer was not coming up out of the crack that it was after that water quit running.
Right, right. That was coming from the springs or sinkholes back up in the park.
Well, that's coming from across there. Isn't that coming from that pond over there?
Nobody, I don't think, really knows. There are people theorize that it was coming from the pond that we just drained and the pond across from Riverview. That's where people say that's where that water eventually drains into. But that's where certainly that the little bit of water that was coming out of that leak was, there was a lot more water coming down that parking lot all summer long.
Yeah, there was more water coming across the parking lot than what the 2-inch line could prevent.
Right.
Speaking of the pond, this is not part of Steve's report, but the base has set and the wiring has been installed and the pumps will be installed tomorrow and we'll start building the pond back up and see for the fountain.
Hey, Martin, will you do me a favor? Tell those guys, they seeded that area around the pond. Tell them to go ahead and straw that.
Okay.
All right. That would help so much.
Keep the seed.
Yeah.
Anything else for Steve? Thanks,
Steve.
Thank you.
You've got Kenny's report here. He still could use a couple more firefighters.
Mayor,
yes.
I realize I don't have a report tonight. Sure. My previous report, I commented on there, but I forgot to publicly thank the fire department and the street department. They've helped with our last couple of parades, and their personnel have been invaluable to us. So I meant to thank them publicly last time and forgot about that, but in his absence tonight, I'd like to thank Kenny and his staff and Dave and his staff for helping us out on that.
Good. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay. Nothing on there. We'll go to the anything else from the board? As far as
committee
meetings?
Reports.
Yes.
We had open house downstairs for community access TV. We had the What's New girls down there signing autographs. Mary Ann, Mary Ann Roth, and Iris Benson gave away a TV, 19-inch TV.
Oh, wow.
Jeff McCarty's daughter. You know her name? She won it. It was a Donnie was there. I saw Donnie. I came in late, but
I come in later.
It was a good show. What's that?
I said I come in later because you were there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a good showcase, and we plan to do it again probably next year. So it's just really, is it? Man, I don't know. But we had the folks, the committee members had a good time, and we had a fair showing for our people coming.
Great.
All right. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, we'll go to the minutes of October the 8th. Why? I don't think there's any public comments. Alicia, you got anything to say? All right.
Motion to approve.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
And closed session October the 8th.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. And treasurer's report for September.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay.
I asked Pam this while ago when we were talking. What page was that on, Pam? Do you remember?
I'm sorry, I don't.
Oh, that's okay.
What's the name of it?
KRCU. It's a radio station. I'm trying to figure out why we're paying them.
KRCU 990?
Yeah, 90.9 FM. Why are we paying them $1,500?
Marketing, for advertising, welcome, I mean, for the tourism. Now, as far as the specifics of the contract, I'd have to get back to you.
I listen to radio all the time. I've never heard of that station. Where are they out of?
That is.
What do we get for it?
Isn't KRCU the university's, SEMO's, I believe that's SEMO's.
PBS.
Radio station for the university, if I remember 30 years ago when I was, 40 years ago when I was there.
I mean, how many is it?
I don't know.
I'll get the answer.
Okay, thank you. All right.
I think that was a call letters for.
Yeah, but I'm just.
Weren't they producing some of the commercials that the other TV stations are playing? I thought Sanders said, or something about a school doing those commercials for.
Could be, I don't know.
I don't know.
We'll find out.
I'll send an email out to all members of the board. And the press.
I don't get an email anymore, so I don't know what happened. I get nothing.
You don't? Okay, I'll check into that.
Nothing anymore.
Somebody made a motion.
I did.
One second.
Anything else?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Resolution 2015-49, a resolution with respect to the annexation of a certain unincorporated area, which.
Is defined by the exhibits.
Yes, that's on the resolution, which is that property we talked about earlier.
Move to approve.
Second.
Who seconded that?
That's all right.
Randy.
Randy, okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, thank you. Old business, there's no old business, new business, bill number 4066, first reading.
An ordinance approving change order number three in the amount of $34,537.20 and a final contract amount of $966,589.20 on the contract with T-Jury Contracting Incorporated of Bloomsdale, Missouri for the St. Genevieve Water Main Replacement Project number 14-5960.
A significant portion of this has to do with the fact that we had planned to run the sewer line on the east side of St. Mary's Road, and we ended up with conflicts with existing utilities that made that not impossible, well, pretty much impossible. So we went to the other side of the road, which was not part of the plan. We didn't secure easements for the first several hundred feet of that, so we had to put it in the road. So they had to do road repair, and that wasn't part of the original contract.
Move approval. Second.
Okay, we seem like we hit these bills all the time with jury contracting. Is this the final one?
Final change order?
Yeah.
Should be.
Okay, this is it.
They're on their last, I mean, they're cleaning up and making connections.
So we're done, no more.
No surprises.
Okay, all right.
Now, I might add, and this was asked earlier of me by another alderman, we had estimated $1.2 million for this project. One of the reasons we were high was because we calculated we were going to have to buy every easement, because you just didn't know if people would give it to you. The other reason is you don't know what the bids are going to be, and we got a favorable bid from Drury, better than our engineer's estimate. So we are well under the funding level.
Good, good.
But $34,000 over the contract.
Couldn't help with that, really.
No.
Did you get that?
And all of that work, you know, is not something they hold you up later, because they have unit prices in there, and they're just applying their unit prices to the work, so.
Right.
Well, and then also, we got a street out of it.
We did.
Yeah.
Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, bill number 4067, first reading.
An ordinance approving a budget amendment to the City of St. Genevieve fiscal year 2016 budget relating to the federal levy fund budget number 45.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Bill number 4068, first reading.
An ordinance approving a budget amendment to the City of St. Genevieve fiscal year 2016 budget relating to the sewer fund budget number 31.
Okay, why is this?
This was for mixers for the million gallon tank at the wastewater treatment plant. Those, the design and putting the project together could not be done until the tank was emptied, so people could come look at it and see what will actually work and what won't work in that tank. So nothing could be done with that project until the tank got low enough that they could perform their work, which was in the fall. So there was no time for me to spend the money after that. We got a new budget.
This was a carryover from last year's budget.
Correct.
So it had to be an amendment in this year's budget. So it's a carryover. It's just moving money, making the audit and the budget work.
I'll second it if nobody else did that.
Yeah, but made the motion. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, thank you. Bill number 4069, first reading.
An ordinance approving a budget amendment to the City of St. Genevieve fiscal year 2016 budget relating to the water fund budget number 30.
Motion to approve.
Once again, what?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Steve.
Due to the wet spring and summer, farmers were unable to get crops in their fields, which in turn prohibits us from applying our lime sludge.
Until they harvest.
Until what?
They couldn't get crops in the field, so you couldn't.
Yeah, you can't land apply. You land apply when the crops come out of the field.
Right. So
they got them in late, so our time frame actually ran in. They started hauling lime sludge on September 29th.
So again,
they got one day hauling done.
Again, that's a carryover from last year. Just moving from last year's, basically last year's budget to this year's budget.
Okay.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Bill number 4070, first reading.
An ordinance of the City of St. Genevieve authorizing the mayor to enter into a contract with the Lafay Cement Finishing Incorporated of Perryville, Missouri, in the amount of $152,993.78 for the Point Base Drive Reconstruction Phase 1 Project 15-6284.
Make a motion to approve.
Donnie, I think. No. Rick, second.
Rick and Joe.
Rick and Joe, okay. Did you get that?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Okay, we have the second reading.
Well, wait, we got one first.
Oh, we have voted.
All in favor of first reading?
Aye.
Opposed?
Okay, right.
Can I make a motion to the second reading of this?
Second.
All in favor of second reading of 4070?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, second reading of number 4070.
An ordinance of the City of St. Genevieve authorizing the mayor to enter into a contract with Lafay Cement Finishing Incorporated of Perryville, Missouri, in the amount of $152,993.78 for the Point Base Drive Reconstruction Phase 1 Project 15-6284.
I'm making a motion to approve.
And second.
And roll call.
Alderwoman Codwell.
Yes.
Alderman Couch.
Yes.
Alderman John Stupi.
Yes.
Alderman Jokers.
Yes.
Alderman Hook.
Yes.
Alderman Donnie Stupi.
Yes.
Alderman Prince.
Yes.
Alderman Ruzicka.
Yes.
8 yes, 0 no's. Bill number 4070 now becomes ordinance 4002.
Okay. Other business, we have the approval of the street closure request for the Lions Club for Rural Heritage Days.
I'm making motion to approve.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Eric, have you seen this list yet?
The street closure?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been through it.
Okay, and the parade?
That's Saturday. It's turned out to be a growing event. A lot of people will come out.
It sounds like it's gonna rain all day.
We're all gonna hope it doesn't rain.
All right, look at the forecast before I left the office this afternoon. Rain's supposed to be over early in the morning.
When?
Yeah.
Early in the morning, Saturday morning.
Yeah, I just heard a while ago that we'll linger on until Sunday.
Well, possibility.
Well, it's a family-friendly.
Got a quick draw coming out here.
Any other business?
I'm making motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.